thousands of years ago, the first human being started to travel across the terrain to find food, shelter, and water. His journey stopped when he started to know the term settlement, or residency, which means to acquire a personal space where all factors of survival are existent, yet with a sense of security. And from this point, mankind knew how to build houses, grew his own food, and take care of his own cattle. From this point, mankind knew how to build a civilization. In decades, maybe centuries, human evolution kept going on from the initial form of civilizations to what we're living in now. However, that global system we made to help us came around to force us to help it grow, crushing all what is weak and fragile to feed the bigger machine moving the money cycle. We lost the cause, falling in a loop circle, losing the main aim, and we were enslaved by our own desires. Unemployment rates raised at the stake, people started to be homeless again, not able to satisfy the capitalism machine, leaving thousands of homeless struggling to eat or merely have shelter.
Everybody's saying the economy's getting better, but I don't see where. I haven't actually worked for almost a year and a half.
Right.
And like I said, you know, most people ain't gonna hire me because I'm homeless.
No.
And they feel like when they see homeless, they're thinking, oh, he's a drunk or a drug addict.
Right.
And neither.
No.
I don't do drugs and I don't drink.
Right.
I gave that all up about 12 years ago.
Never has unemployment been so high for so long, and as a result, more than 16 million kids are living in poverty, the most since 1962. It's worst where the construction industry collapsed, and one of those places is Central Florida. We went there 8 months ago to meet families who'd become homeless for the first time in their lives. So many were living day to day that school buses changed their routes to pick up all the kids living in cheap motels. We called the story Hard Times Generation.
These first-year biology students at Madrid's Autonomous University are among the lucky ones, or so they thought. They're some of the 30% of Spanish youths who go to university, but with the long recession, they're worried that their degrees won't help them get jobs, even 4 years from now.
I'm a biology student. When the crisis hit, they cut funding for scientific research a lot, so I'm sure I'll have to go to another country to do research or whatever, because here there's no guaranteed work in scientific investigation.
It would likely not make them feel any better to meet 27-year-old Silvana Fernandez, a woman with two business degrees who that same day was having her first experience in an unemployment line.
They told her that it was a very good career to have, a double degree, and that we would find job very easily, and it wasn't like that. And we are not able to do a normal life of a 27-year-old boy or girl, so.
We were saying how very important it is to bring about in the human mind the radical revolution. The crisis is a crisis in consciousness, a crisis that cannot anymore accept the old norm, the old patterns, the ancient traditions. And considering what the world is now, with all the misery, conflict, destructive brutality, aggression, and so on, man, he's still as he was. He's still brutal, violent, aggressive, acquisitive, competitive, and he has built a society along these lines.
It was clear the system couldn't help itself. The outgrowing numbers of youth and the ever-growing passion was not to be compared at all by the obsolete rigged sight of the capitalist dream. Riots, wars, and genocides happened, which was the biggest clue to prove that we're falling.
We have created this society. Not each one of us, but our past generations. We have those and us have created this present immoral, destructive society. And we are trapped by that society. That society is made by each one of us. So we are responsible for that society. Whether it is possible not to change society, but is it possible to radically, deeply transform our condition, which is understand deeply our consciousness, which is what we are. Is it possible to transform not into something, but to change, bring about a mutation in the very structure and nature of our consciousness?
We failed. In all aspects of what failure is, there is no urge about that. The idea of society is absurd and built on contradictory values. Mankind have failed to sustain the idealist form of community.
Some of the good people of both races who live under the protection of the United States may not be satisfied with the decision of the Supreme Court.
It's utterly striking how deep we failed to build an equally treated society, not based on materialism or racism. A society where we don't discriminate based on religious views, colors, or currency. So naturally, the idea have been born, a nomadic lifestyle, a simple approach to live out of the system, but in fact, fight the system. Those youth who they called hippies were mainly the revolutionaries of the 60s, threw back all the rigid teachings and their father's manuals to live their lives. It was a booming scene and everyone was joining. A new liberal wave fighting the old conservative one. All right.
Thank you.
art piece. The Wave was originally founded in the United States fighting the oppressed police forces and the teachings of the Catholic Church. Though the Wave was revolutionary, however, it was also mainly about music. One of the most popular events at that time was the one-time Woodstock Festival. It took 2 weeks to build a stage and they had to rent the land from the owner for the better cause. It was huge and first of this kind. A true music revolution was about to be born. People were coming from everywhere across the states to attend it. Everybody just built tents and stayed there for days of rock music.
If you smile at me, you know I will understand, 'cause that is something everybody everywhere does in the same language.
In just a couple of days, everybody heard about this concert and people started flooding from everywhere. And almost all the influential bands at the time, including the Grateful Dead, Janis Joplin and Jimi Hendrix, performed in just a passionate atmosphere with thousands of people watching, and that folded the name of the hippies in that one concert.
You must try some of my purple berries.
In this age of protests, one of the most recent finds 4,000 Londoners decrying British support for US action in Vietnam. There were a few minor scuffles, but no arrests. The demonstrators were stopped from approaching Prime Minister Wilson's Downing Street home. Organized by the Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament, mimics of Queen Elizabeth presented mock medals and said the war was a wicked obscenity.
The problem wasn't solved. In fact, it got bigger. Thousands of homeless people and hundreds of thousands unemployed, with the chances getting less. The humankind still suffers his own simple living.
The point is that you have to work. And that's why the propaganda system is so successful. Very few people are going to have the time or the energy or the commitment to carry out the constant battle that's required to get outside of, McNeely or Dan Rather or somebody like that. The easy thing to do, you come home from work, you're tired, you've had a busy day, you're not going to spend the evening carrying out a research project. So you turn on the tube and say, it's probably right. Or you look at the headlines in the paper and then you watch the sports or something. That's basically the way the system of indoctrination works. Sure, the other stuff is there, but you're going to have to work to find it.
Modern industrial civilization has developed within a certain system of convenient myths. The driving force of modern industrial civilization has been individual material gain, which is accepted as legitimate, even praiseworthy, on the grounds that private vices yield public benefits, in the classic formulation. Now, it's long been understood very well that a society that is based on this principle will destroy itself in time. It can only persist with whatever suffering and injustice it entails, as long as it's possible to pretend that the destructive forces that humans create are limited, that the world is an infinite resource, and that the world is an infinite garbage can. At this stage of history, either one of two things is possible. Either the general population will take control of its own destiny and will concern itself with community interests, guided by values of solidarity and sympathy and concern for others, or alternatively, there will be no destiny for anyone to control. As long as some specialized class is in a position of authority, it is going to set policy in the special interests that it serves. But the conditions of survival, let alone justice, require rational social planning in the interests of the community as a whole, and by now that means the global community.
The idea of leaving the system behind may be a little difficult. to digest, were very insightful, leaving the culture and creating a new way of life, which is the right way to live nowadays. Building new communities, founding new cities in deserted places and spreading across the globe, not relying or relying on money or currency, growing food, building houses and much more. The scene was overgrown, naturally across the globe, then it got connected by a global growing culture that was mainly connected by mutual interest and the internet. The new way of communication. People started to leave their heavy lives behind, their bills, their rents, their fake idealist society in general, and they just started traveling.
February 15th, 2011, the New Age Nomads are born. Who are the New Age Nomads? My name is Mondo.
And my name is Dallas. We are two adventurous individuals who both found ourselves unhappy with our day-to-day lives, and it was time for a change.
And a drastic one at that.
What civilization is 6 billion people trying to make themselves happy by standing on each other's shoulders and kicking each other's teeth in. It's not a pleasant situation. And yet, you can stand back and look at this planet and see that we have the money, the power, the medical understanding, the scientific know-how, the love, and the community to produce a kind of human paradise. Culture is not your friend. Culture is for other people's convenience and the convenience of various institutions, churches, companies, tax collection schemes, what have you. It is not your friend. It insults you. It disempowers you. It uses and abuses you. None of us are well treated by culture. And yet we glorify, you know, the creative potential of the individual, the rights of the individual. We understand the felt presence of experience is what is most important, but the culture is a perversion. It fetishizes objects, creates consumer mania, it preaches endless forms of false happiness, endless forms of false understanding in the form of swirly religions and silly cults. It invites people to diminish themselves and dehumanize themselves by behaving like machines, meme processors of memes passed down from Madison Avenue and Hollywood and what have you.
A lot of places started to gain limited popularity among travelers across Earth. Most of these places were already categorized as a third world, where capitalism didn't acquire much space there. Life is still simple and cheap, just relying on the main points of surviving, and the rest is left to be extracted out of nature itself. A lot of people were interested in the nomadic life ages ago. Scientists and freethinkers were always trying to focus on pushing the masses to innovate new ways of living out of the tiring monetary system. Though these communities are so underrated and underground, yet it got popular in the recent years. These nomadic communities started to attract people from everywhere as tourists who want to escape their lives for a couple of days. Some of these communities, or so-called camps, are in Australia, Cambodia, Africa, and Asia. Here in Egypt, and especially Sinai, real Arabian and Jordanian tribes are the natives of the land.
Oh,
their small communities and camps have attracted a lot of people around the world to this way of life based on simplicity and beauty. It has gained much popularity the later years, growing its own community mixed with Bedouins, foreigners and Egyptians, forming a new mixed culture and a new lifestyle.
It's okay. It's actually better because the owner of the place, eh?
Maybe it sounds funny how humanity evolved to get back to one point, which is to live like a traveler, however it's insightful, to look in depth, to live simply. Pro-nature living is maybe one of the least options we didn't choose to try until now.
Eros and the eschaton, these are the two areas that I think compromise the old paradigm and give permission to hope, and strangely, neither of these words is that well known, which gives you a measure of how completely the dominator position has squelched, subverted, and downplayed any opposition to its worldview. Eros we know about in some kind of devalued, sticky, kind of glitzy way, because we get it in the eroticization of media and society. But really what eros means in the Greek sense is a kind of unity of nature, a kind of all-pervasive order that bridges one ontological level to another. This is not permitted worldview of our civilization, which is science. The world of inorganic chemistry is not thought to make any statement about the organic world, and the organic world is not thought to be extrapolatable into the world of culture and thought. There are imagined to be clear breaks categories. I had a biologist tell me once, if genes aren't involved, it ain't evolution. So that means you can't talk about the evolution of the earth as a physical body. You can't talk about the evolution of human social institutions. Evolution is somehow a word appropriate to biology and appropriate nowhere else. And this brings me then to the first factor easily discerned by anybody who has their eyes open that compromises and erodes the hopeless existential view of the world that we're getting from science. And that is the idea that nature is in fact across all scales and all levels of phenomena a unity. It's not a coincidence that electrons spinning around.
Have you ever thought of leaving the system?
Yes, I have thought of leaving the system a lot because the daily routine can be boring sometimes and it can be very busy, so people will need to take
I think when you're my age, you have the opportunity to go traveling.
Yes, definitely. I'm not satisfied with how things are right now, so naturally I want to leave this system.
I like to have few lives, lots of different lives in one. Because I get bored quickly, I think, or I don't know. I like to change, I like to see the new landscape.
If you have the chance to get out of the system, will you take it?
Yes, right away. The minute a chance appears in front of me, I'm definitely going to take it.
Yes, I would, because I'd like to take a break of my own.
Okay. What do you think about living like a traveler?
If you go on a holiday, you're just enjoying your time. See a little bit, look a little bit to like wherever you are. See the nature and maybe like temples or whatever. And if you're traveling, you just meet so many people, and it's not only the traveling, but it's also the people.
I think it will be interesting, but on some level it's difficult, because in some countries there's a different level of tolerance when it comes to people from different nationalities going to their own country. But I guess if I went with like a popular choice like the US, for example, it would be easy for me if I obtain a visa that it's like a study visa, if I'm studying something particular. But in order to sustain that, it's difficult, because I can't really show the government that I'm working, because supposedly I'm there to study. So that conflicts with my original intent, according to them. So it would be quite interesting.
Fanno delle tratte in gruppo, poi ci si incontra, comunque non ci si sente raramente solo, capita poco, ma c'è una.
Thank you.